I was interested in, say, chip amplifiers, and searched the World Wide Web and searched also for the data sheets. And this is the circuit that I published earlier. It's the TDA2003. And when you study these data sheets, they are often made for automotive applications. There is a distortion when such a chip gets to its maximum output volume. So they say, for instance, it's 10 watt, but on 10 watt you have, for instance, 10% distortion. But I found another chip that did not have this problem, at least looking at the data sheet. So I ordered a few of them. They are here. It's the TDA2615. And this is also a chip that I ordered, but perhaps that will be in another video. So let's put it aside. This is the chip where it's all about. And this chip had, according to the datasheet, very low distortion. And it was rated for 2 × 6 watt. So in my ID, that could be a very interesting chip. So I ordered a few of them and made this circuit. And you can see, for instance, that this chip has 2 loudspeakers out. It's a stereo chip, so 2 loudspeaker boxes can be supplied, and you can use it with a symmetrical or a non-symmetrical power supply. Maximum voltage is 21 volts. It was perhaps made for 12 volt, I don't know that exactly. But, well, I made this circuit and it proved to be very good, very interesting. It really has a pure sound, so when you lift up the input volume, there is no audible distortion. And that's very good. You see how I made it. I have given this chip a kind of endless heatsink. That was more or less salvaged out of, say, an old amplifier or so. And here are all the, say, components around that chip. Input capacitor is input capacitor is 220 nanofarad. That's not much, but anyway, when you look to the data sheet on the World Wide Web, this is the right value, and also here, so 2 channels left and right or right and left, and I've mounted here a input potentiometer volume control of 100 kilo ohms, so 100,000 ohms. Input capacitor, I say here it could be between 220 nanofarad or 470 nanofarad. And say I have related that to the value here, 220 nanofarad. So, anyway, don't forget to solder this wire in between pin 3 and pin 8. And when you, say, want to use this chip, I found that it is a good idea to move some pins upwards. So pin 2 and pin 3 and other pins, they are visible here, are moved upwards, and that makes it more easy to solder the components to the chip with, say, such a soldering iron that is quite coarse. This is a coarse soldering iron, so I always have to look not to connect two pins with solder when I'm soldering to such a chip anyway. One of the most important things regarding such a chip is that it is not critical. I have, for instance, in the past bought audio chips of say 10 watt, and they could not be mounted here in such a way. With brass pins on a piece of wood, they started to oscillate or whatever, and when you see data sheets where there is a very critical description of how such a chip has to be mounted, for instance with a ring at its output, a guarding ring connected to ground, you can more or less be sure that that is a critical chip when you want to use it in a hobby application like I do. Back again to the circuit, here are all the pins. Here is a small, say, indication of where you have to start to count all the pins, 9 pins in this case. And this is more or less the complete circuit. I've used here a 3.3 ohm resistor, that's here, but you can also bridge that. Advice is go to the data sheet on the World Wide Web and see what's the function of this resistor. Maximum 21 volts. So let's listen to the sound and see whether it is really undistorted. That's what is claimed. Put up the input level now to the maximum. This is the other loudspeaker. So, this chip, originally made by Philips, claims that it has a very low distortion, and yes, it's true. So, when you want to make a good and simple audio stereo amplifier, use this chip. That's an advice, a good advice. Very, very easy chip and a very properly functioning chip. Let's see what it takes at, regarding to the current 20 volts, that's approximately the maximum. And this is also very, very good. So it's a real class B amplifier. It doesn't take current when there is no signal, audio signal at its input. Let's look at the scope. Also a very, very good, say, scope view about this music signal. And I've used here by purpose a kind of endless heatsink. You can see that here. Perhaps you have to study the data sheet for the, say, a usable heatsink for, say, other output levels. But this is, in my opinion, a kind of endless heatsink. So in such a case, the chip works, in my opinion. And of course, when you have room to use such a endless heatsink, the chip works at its best. And furthermore, not much components are needed. Only a few electrolytics, a few resistors. So here you can see that. Two electrolytics for both channels. Here the Zobel network, two times that Zobel network. And here 100 microfarad capacitor going to ground. And here the power supply capacitor, that's here, with a 100 nanofarad capacitor soldered between the positive and the negative, and I have by purpose soldered in a 220K resistor. So here in my circuit there's also a 220,000 ohms resistor. Anyway, interesting chip to make a very simple amplifier with a very good sound, and perhaps interesting to tell the bass boost amplifier that I published earlier does not work in combination with this chip. So I have to say develop another bass boost amplifier. But anyway, when you operate this chip on say 3 watt, also the bass frequencies are very properly amplified. And a good thing that when you study the data sheet, the Bose inputs of this chip are say connected to ground, not directly, but with a 10k or 30k resistor. That's important. That limits all kinds of say impedance problems at the input.